Name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Good to see you here in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church today. We welcome every one of you. We appreciate the members and visitors the same. We appreciate you being here. May God bless you. Always glad to have visitors visiting with us here at Northside. And you that's listening out in the radio listening audience, most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour. We do have a good Sunday morning listening audience. We appreciate that. And we'll always count on our audience maybe to call friends and have them to tune in and get the Northside Baptist Church Hour. So during this hour coming up, we want to be a real blessing. Now I want you to come tonight and get in all the good singing. You'll be hearing other singers tonight as well as the Blessed Hope singers, the choir, solos, duets, and maybe some good musical playing here tonight. Maybe the Bruce boys will have their instruments all set up here tonight. Well, we're just going to have a good time. I want you to come and be with us if you can in the service here beginning at 6 o'clock. Now, take your Bible, turn to Luke chapter 16, and while you're turning there, I want to mention our tape. We have 240 tape listed. Tape today will be tape number 242. I'm going to speak on what the rich man discovered in hell 60 seconds after death. What the rich man discovered in hell 60 seconds after death. That'll be my subject. It'll be tape number 242. These tapes are $3 each. The gift is used to help defray our radio expense. And you can read a list of these tapes and just pick out what you want. And they are good messages, I think. Good tape, rather, in general. That is the music. We preach to you the Bible, of course. You can't beat that. The Bible is the Word of God. And, well, you have 240, so you can pick out the ones you want. Request a brochure on our proposed Holy Land tour. You might want to look it over. You might be interested. Turn to Luke chapter 16. We're getting a few little showers of rain around, but not too much right here at Northside. Let's keep praying for rain. It's still dry. I read the other day where this man went out in his popcorn field and stuff and started popping and flying up in the air. It's hot and coming down and some cows standing nearby. And they thought it was snowing and they're standing there shaking, almost freezing to death. You have all kind of things happening. I didn't see that. I just read that. And by doing this hot, dry weather, you have a lot of things happening. Man got away, couldn't spit, and he's trying to prime himself to be able to spit once in a while. The weather was so dry and hot. So many things happen during the hot weather. But maybe the Lord will give us a good rain one of these days, and we can just walk in the rain and the mud. I'd be willing to walk in the mud up to my knees. How about you? Amen. If it ever starts raining good, Brother Gibson, I think I just get out in it and just stand out there like a wooden Indian. Just let it rain. All right. Luke chapter 16, I'm going to speak on what the rich man discovered 60 seconds after he landed in hell. Now, Jesus is the one that tells us here about hell. Now, this is not a parable. The no-hellites, the cult, the Russellites, the so-called Jehovah's Witnesses, which are not really Jehovah's Witnesses, they're Satan's Witnesses. Jehovah is God, and they most certainly don't represent God in any means. They're Satan's witnesses. They'll tell you that this is a parable. But nowhere in the Bible did Jesus ever call a man's name in a parable. Nowhere. This is a story that actually happened, and Jesus tells about it. Luke chapter 16, verse 19. There was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. There was a certain beggar named Lazarus which was laid at his gate full of sores and desired to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. Preacher Green, the late evangelist Oliver B. Green, asked me years ago, said, "Preacher Edwards, do you know the name of them dogs that licked Lazarus' sores?" I said, "I sure don't." He said, "Well, it tells you right there in verse 21, Moreover there, Moreover the dogs, he said that's who they were. But anyway, it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels in Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And in hell he lifted up his eyes, being in torments, and seeing Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool his tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receiveth thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things, but now he is comforted and thou art tormented. And beside all this, between us and you, there's a great gulf fixed, so that they which are passing hence you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. And he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, thou wouldst send him to my father's house, for I have five brethren that may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. Abraham saith unto him, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. And he said, Nay, Father Abraham, if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. And he said unto him, If they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. Now that's reading from Luke chapter 16, verses 19 through 31. But there's some things here that this man discovered. This man, the rich man, the Dives he's called, discovered in hell in 30 seconds after he ended up there. Now Jesus is the greatest hellfire teacher and hellfire preacher that ever lived. He tells us more about hell than all the others put together. Now Jesus Christ is the one that built hell, and he knows all about it, and he tells us about it here. Hell is mentioned many, many times in the Bible. There is a place called hell. There's a place called heaven. If you deny the fact of hell, you might as well deny the fact of heaven, because the same Lord tells us about both. And if we can't believe what he says to live it, the Bible is true. Every word in it is inspired of God. I believe in the inerrant Bible. The inerrancy of this book is not an error in it anywhere. It's God's holy word. It's infallible. It's inspired. And you better believe that. Now this man in hell discovered some things in a matter of 30 seconds after he ended up there. You may say, now Preacher Edwards, how you know he arrived there in 30 seconds? Well, the Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. That's for the Christian. And the same Bible said here that the rich man died, and in hell he lifted up his eyes. It didn't say he waited 5 minutes or 10 minutes. By the time his soul left his body, he was in the flames of hell, there in his soulless body, screaming in the regions of the damned. Now he discovered, number one, that death does not end at all. Now there's a lot of people in this world today, and there's a lot of people today committing suicide. And a lot of people are saying, well, I think I'll just end it all. I'll go ahead and take my life. If I get killed, I'll just end it all. No. Death does not end it all. Now, you get that in your head. If I'm speaking to someone today and you think when you die that that's going to end it all, you better do some more thinking. The Bible says in verses 22 and 23, the rich man also died and was buried. And in hell he lifted up his eyes. They buried his body, but he received a soulless body. Down in hell he had eyes, feet, hands, legs, ears. He had a soulless body in hell, but he had a physical, literal body in the grave, waiting for him to go back into that body at the great white throne judgment. And so death does not end at all. Now you better remember that the devil will tell you a lie. The devil will tell you that if you die, then you're out of your misery. You're all right. Everything's fine when you die because you won't know anything. Now that's a lie of the devil. Now the devil is a lie and the father of lies. Did you know about 1,000 young people? Now you listen to this. About 1,000 of our young people try to commit suicide in America every day. Most of them do not succeed, but they try it. They attempt it. Now, the reason for that is because of their own dope and all kind of alcohol and smoking and running wild. And daddy works on the first shift. Mama works on the night shift. And the young ones shift for themselves. And they run out of anywhere to shift, so they think they just go ahead and commit suicide. Now, you need to realize our young people need care and love and understanding. And when parents turn them loose and let them go and run with the crowd, don't be surprised that I'm committing suicide. You have a lot of illegitimate children being born today just to get welfare money. Yonder in the city of New York, understand every time a woman gives birth to illegitimate child, she'd draw about $600 more welfare every month. Down yonder in Mississippi, whenever a woman gives birth to illegitimate child, she'd draw $150 more a month. And they welcome those illegitimate children. And it's bad, it's wrong, it's sinful, it's wicked. But that's what's happening in this land, and something's got to be done about that. And they come here in order for the parents, or rather for their mother, to draw the welfare, or their grandmother. Many of them don't know who their daddy are or where he is. He's neither their daddy nor their granddaddy. And so the mothers have to try to take care of them. They can't handle them. And they run wild, and they get on dope and rob and steal and kill. And it's getting worse and going to keep on getting worse. Now you need to realize that. It's getting worse all the time. And if something's not done to curb it, it's going to keep getting worse. As long as you pay people to have illegitimate children, they're going to have them. Now, if you make it rough, whenever they have them, what they ought to do, they ought to find the daddy of that young'un and make him support that child. And if he's not willing to support that child, ought to put him in the chain gang and let him work for the county or the state or wherever. If the state has got to feed his illegitimate young'un, let him work for the county. Let him stay in the chain gang until the young'un gets 18 if he's not willing to feed it. That would cut out some of that stuff. These young men running around fathering these illegitimate children, and then they disappear. The mother has to take care of them. She don't wear that half the time. The welfare has to feed them and take your tax money to do it. Get that low-down, sorry daddy and do something with him and put a stop to it. Now, we got to learn some sense in this country and wake up. You don't have long to live as a true America as you once known it. Do something with those men, not let the mother. Now, she wants that. She wants those illegitimate children to get more money, draw more money, and get you a tax money. But he don't give a rip, and she don't care where he is. But I'll tell you, the welfare people ought to find out where he is and put him out here in prison and let him pick up this trash on the highway some of it once in a while and do something and help make his bread and butter since they have to take care of the young. And say amen to that. Amen. All right, that's fine. Talk back to this preacher once in a while. Said amen to me. It's like hauling sick him to a coon dog. I'd like to hear from you. And so we find your death does not end at all. The empty tomb is the answer to this. Now, whenever they went to the tomb of Jesus, they found that it was empty. Now, that didn't end at all. He wasn't there. Their body was there. Later, it came out. Secondly, that God has a record of his sins. Now, when this rich man ended up in hell, he found out that God had a record of his sins. Now, he knows about that, and that's why he's so miserable. He's got to face that record at the great white throne judgment of God. When a man dies and goes to hell, he knows he's got a record waiting for him at the great white throne judgment bar of God. Now he's got to face every sin he's ever committed. It'll be brought before him. That is the man that dies in his sins, the man that dies lost. Now when you get saved, God blots out your past record. And you don't have to face your record from your physical birth to your spiritual birth. Your record has its beginning at your spiritual birth. And that's the one that you'll face at the bema seat of Christ. But every sinner's got to face his old sinful record. Every sin he's ever committed going to be brought out on him at the judgment bar of God. Verse 25, Abraham said, Son, remember, in thy lifetime thou receivest thy good things. See, the Abraham is saying, you need to do a little thinking down there, Mr. Dives. In your lifetime, you know what you received? Can't you look back and know what you received, what you did, how that you gained your wealth and what you did with it? Don't you remember those things? He's reminding him there's a record kept. God has that record. You need to do some thinking. In Revelation chapter 20 and verse 12, the Bible said, I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books opened, another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things as written in the books according to their works. See, God has those books. God will keep those books. He's the best bookkeeper that ever existed. There's no errors in God's books. And he has your record in that book if you die a sinner. Now, if you die a Christian, God wipes out the sinful record and starts your new record. And you'll meet that one at the judgment seat of Christ to determine your degree of reward. The only thing that will cover sin today is the blood of Jesus Christ. And if the blood's not applied, those sins are wide open, will be revealed. You'll see them at the great white throne judgment of God. You must remember that. God saved me back yonder in the city of Greenville, South Carolina, in 1940. I'm a Georgia boy. I was born here in the Red Hills of Georgia, out here in Madison County, and grew up out there as a lad till I was 17 years old. But I was saved in Greenville. Now my record started as a baby out here in Madison County. And then when I got saved at the age of 21 in the city of Greenville, God blotted out all of my record from the age 21 back. God blotted it right out. God doesn't even know about it. It's in the seal of forgetfulness. It'll never be brought up against me. But God started my record in 1940 there in the city of Greenville. That'll be the record I'll face at the judgment seat of Christ. And you'll face your record in that manner. If you die without God, you'll face all of your wicked record. Every bit of it is a judgment bar of God. Only the blood of Jesus can take care of those sins. Number three, Satan has lied to him. Satan lied to this rich man. Satan told him a lie. Satan told him, go ahead, live it up, have a good time, because you're wealthy and there's nothing keeping you from having a good time in this life. Going to live a long time and you can just have a ball every day, eat, drink, and be merry. And worry about nothing. That's what the devil tells every sinner. In John chapter 8 and verse 44, Jesus talking to these Pharisees said, you of your father the devil, and the lust of your father you'll do, and he was a murderer from the beginning, and he abode not in the truth, because there's no truth in him. And when he speaks a lie, because he speaks of his own, for he is a lie and the father of lies. Now, Jesus said to these Pharisees, you're just like your daddy, the devil. You tell lies like your daddy, the devil. All lies come from the devil. Now, he lied about the time to get right with God. Now, the devil told old Dives, said, now, you got plenty of time to get right with God. Don't you worry about what Moses is saying and what the prophets are saying. You got plenty of time. You're a young man. You're living in luxury. And you just got plenty of time to get right, so don't worry about that. He lied about the sinner facing his sins. The devil told him, said, now listen, Dives, don't you worry about how you've lived it up and how you've had your great cocktail parties and had your balls and all kind of entertainment in dance halls and so forth. Don't you worry about anything in the world, because you won't have to worry about that. You just go ahead and have a good time. Drink your liquor, beer, and wine, and smoke your pot. Have a good time. Get out and rip up and down the highway in your beautiful carriage and your fine horses. You got nothing to worry about. He lied about the time to get right with God. He said, you got a long time yet. I've talked with people about their souls that said, well, I'm young. I got plenty of time. Well, there's people in hell that said that, and they were young when they went to hell. That's bad. He lied about him facing his sins. The devil told him, you won't have to worry about your sins. He lied about the brevity of life. The devil said, you're in good health. You know, you go to the doctor every so often and you get a physical and you're looking good. You have no pains in your body. Everything is fine. Everything is in your favor. And don't worry about the brevity of life. You've got a long time to live. But did he? No, the Bible said he died and in hell he lifted up his eyes. There the devil lied to him. Number four, that there's a literal fire in hell. No doubt the no hellites, the liberals, the Russellites, and all of that crowd, and the Seventh-day Adventists and all those cults told him in his day, said, there's no fire in hell. You don't have to worry about fire in hell. While you mentioned fire being in hell, and these poor old ignorant so-called Jehovah's Witnesses to laugh at you. They are not intelligent enough to know that fire in the Bible means fire. Well, they don't know. You say fire, they don't know it means fire. They might think it means alpha pi or something. They don't know any better. Poor deceived people. I saw one sitting on the street the other day, and I have a tract that says 15 reasons why I'll not be, could not be a Jehovah's Witness. I saw she was sitting there, had all that watchtower literature, and I said, listen, woman, I got a problem. I said, I have here a little pamphlet here that I can't quite get straightened out here. And if you'll straighten me out on this, maybe I can come on with you here. And I handed the pamphlet, and she glanced at it and said, well, when can I see you again? I said, I'll be passing by. I said, you go ahead and straighten this your pamphlet out and tell me, there's 15 reasons there. It tells you why I couldn't be a Jehovah's Witness because I didn't mention the name. I was trying to get the fish hook in, get a bite before I jerked the hook. And so I gave her that pamphlet. I hope she read the thing and let those false prophets read it. That's I got out on the street giving out that junk. And she'll tell me if she'll clear those 15 reasons up, then I might go down and join that outfit. Because if she cleared that up, then she'd have to be a real independent fundamental Bible-believing Baptist. Couldn't be anything else if she get straightened out. But the devil will tell you a lie, and then he says there's no fire in hell. Verse 24, and he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus, that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue. I'm tormented in this flame. Now, you know what a flame is. You know what fire is. These liberals and modernists and infidels, they try to explain that away. The Word of God declares there's fire in hell. In Mark chapter 9, verses 43 and 44, if thy hand offend thee, cut it off. It's better for thee to enter into life maimed than having two hands to go into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where the worm doth not and the fire is not quenched. Who said that? God. Jesus Christ said that. Jesus said there's fire burning in hell. Now you can't change that. A man's a fool to try to change that. If you change that, you might as well change water and bread and everything else mentioned in the Bible. It will. You can't do it. You must take the Bible as it is. The liberals take the fire out of hell. They don't want to hear about it. Many preachers never preach on hell anymore. You go to some of these big shot churches, they ask those members, how long has it been since your pastor's preached on hell? I said, well, I don't guess I can ever recall him preaching on hell. Well, why doesn't he preach on hell? Doesn't believe it. He doesn't believe the Bible. That's why he doesn't preach on hell. He's a liberal. He's been trained in these denominational seminaries, and they told him no such place as hell. And that's pitiful. When a man won't preach on hell and never preaches on hell and never mentions hell, that's a proof that he doesn't believe in hell. If he doesn't believe in hell, he doesn't believe the Bible like God put it in this book. If a man never preaches on the second coming of Jesus Christ, on the return of the Lord, the rapture, the revelation, that means he doesn't believe it. Either he's ignorant and doesn't understand it. Now, preachers that are called of God usually preach the whole counsel of God. Now, there's a lot of them just starting and never really got into the book that's ignorant and don't know what it's all about, but they're learning, and as soon as they find out, they'll preach it. And so there's literal fire in hell. Number five, he learned that he'd missed the greatest thing in life. Now let this sink in just a moment. Here's a man that had missed the greatest thing in life. He had the most beautiful, shiny chariot that could roll down the streets of Jerusalem. No doubt he had the finest horses that ever hitched a chariot. No doubt he had the finest armor, the most beautiful swords. He had gold and silver, had the most delicious food, finest place to live, had servants. This man had anything that he wanted, but he missed the greatest thing in life. Now, money, stocks and bonds, land and houses, lots and funny tour, good job, and all that is not the greatest thing in life. Those things come in handy once in a while as you travel down this road to eternity. They could be good to you and help you along the way, but that's not the greatest thing in life. This man missed the greatest thing in life, and the greatest thing in life is your salvation. His own salvation that he missed. And if you gain the whole world and lose your soul, you're the loser. Jesus said, what will a man have if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? Your soul is far more valuable than all the wealth of this world. So he missed the greatest thing in life, number one, which is salvation. Secondly, winning others to Christ. One of the greatest things you can do in life is not becoming strong physically or becoming a politician or living out in the realm of sports and becoming a great athlete. That's not the greatest thing in life. The greatest thing in life for you as a Christian is winning somebody to Jesus. That's the greatest thing you do. That's more important than all the world, winning somebody to Jesus. And then, of course, looking for a reward. This man here had nothing to look forward to. Looking for a reward, that was never phased him, never thought about it. He had everything with him. He must have thought he was going to take it on with him when he died. He was well fixed. When a man dies, the only thing he owns, about 6 foot of the ground, what you'll own when you die. Everybody goes under their equal. Can't carry a thing with you. You brought nothing in the world. You can take nothing out. Somebody asked about a rich man that died and said, well, how much did he leave behind? The fellow said, well, he left it all. You can take a thing with him when he died. And you're going to leave it all. You won't take anything with you when you die. Number six, he still had his memory. When this man went to hell, he carried with him his memory. He could think about everything that came to his mind. He could remember from just a child until he died. Down there in hell, he thought about everything that happened, how close he came maybe to attending a worship service, how somebody tried to win him to God, somebody tried to get him to do right. He thought of all of these things. He could remember how he had a chance maybe to be saved. In verse 25, Abraham said, son, remember. He could remember how his loved ones, no doubt, some of them did maybe live right. Maybe he heard, he could remember the preacher's sermon that he heard the preacher preach occasionally. People in hell today and that die and go to hell will remember every church that they ever passed by and had temptation to go in. Or every sermon they ever heard preached, every time somebody tried to win them to Jesus, they'll remember that. They're down there in hell, they remember those things, and that's bad. Number seven, he saw all opportunities to be saved are gone forever. Now, sometimes things can get away and you can get them back. But some things go and are gone forever. You never get them back. And whenever you die and go to hell, your opportunity to get saved is gone forever. Hindsight is better than foresight. You can look back many years, you this middle-aged and over, and look back where you could have done differently and maybe been in a better position than you are now. That's gone forever. You might could do better. But when you go to hell, all opportunities are gone. You can never make any change. Verse 31, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither they persuade the one rose from the dead. That's no second chance. There's no such thing as purgatory. Purgatory is a lie of the devil. That's the filthy, stinking rags of Rome hashed out of hell. That's not of God. That's not of the Bible. No such place as purgatory. When a person dies and goes to hell, that's it. He can never, never come back and do anything over. That's no second chance. He had not a word in reply when he received no water. He got no water. He did not say any more about it. He knew that was it. There'd be no water for him to drink. And he realized that. He couldn't change it. Not a thing he could do about it. There's a man one time that killed a feller, and he killed this man in the presence of that man's two little children. Shot him down in cold blood murder. He couldn't sleep. He couldn't rest. They put him in jail. They sentenced him to the electric chair where they should have. And he was sitting there on death's row. And someone asked him, said, wouldn't you like to have an appeal? Wouldn't you like to, for this to be changed, maybe reduced to life in prison? He said, no, sir. He said, no, sir. Let me go on the electric chair. I can't stand this any longer. This thing bothers me night and day. My conscience is running me crazy. I see those little boys there when I shot their daddy and how they look. And I see the man I killed in cold blood murder. I can't get it off my mind. Let me go to the electric chair and end it all. But wait a minute. Going to the electric chair didn't end it all. No. Jumping out of the frying pan in the fire doesn't help matters. Going to the electric chair and dropping off in the hell makes it worse. And he thought if he went to the electric chair, he'd just end it all. But you don't end it all at death. No, sir. If he didn't get right with God and went to the electric chair, he went straight to hell as a Martin to his going. Beloved, you don't end it all at death. And if someone out there in the radio listening audience in this audience here and you think about taking your life, that's foolish. That doesn't end it all. You just jump out of the frying pan right smack into the fire. And you're far worse than ever. And then you can do nothing about it. What you need is the Lord. Repent and get right with God. Receive Christ as your Savior and let God come into your heart. Dives, realize these seven things I mentioned 30 seconds after he went to hell, but it's too late to do anything about it. Today you can do something about why you stand before God. Let's stand to our feet. Father in heaven, I pray in Jesus' name that you will speak to this audience and that you will speak to the radio listening audience and that somebody today might get saved and escape hell. We know hell is waiting for every lost person that's living without Jesus. God, speak to hearts today. Have your way, our Father, with this message in the radio listening audience and in this congregation. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Debbie's playing for us, and while she plays, listen to me. If you're here unsaved, backslidden, or you want to join the church, you want to come forward for any reason the Spirit of God's prompting you to come, won't you come? Don't just stand back and hesitate, be reluctant about it. Come right on now. Just move right out and let us help you this morning. We'd certainly like to help you. Would you come? Come on, if you'd like to get right, join the church. For any reason the Spirit of God is prompting you to move, come on. We're going to give you time.